Good morning and welcome to the Berks County Board of Commissioners meeting for November the 13th. We will begin with a moment of silence followed by a pledge.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
The first item on our agenda is a public hearing. It's in accordance with resolution number 305-14, which was adopted by the Berks County Board of Commissioners on October the 2nd, 2014. This is a public hearing to consider the board's intention to organize a new joint municipal transit authority merging the Red Rose Transit Authority of Lancaster County and the Berks Area Regional Transit Authority of Berks County, and further to consider adoption of resolution number 349-14, approving the amendment of the Articles of Incorporation of Berks Area Regional Transportation Authority to be effective January 1st, 2015, and the adoption of resolution number 350-14, approving the new joint transit authority to be known as the South Central Transit Authority. With that, we will open up for the public hearing. Who is going to
Dave Kilmer is going to make a presentation.
Yeah, Dave Kilmer, who is actually the acting director of BARTA and has been for
over a year.
Dave, welcome.
Thank you. Thank you, and I appreciate the opportunity to give you a little presentation on our proposal. I do have a little PowerPoint that hopefully all the electronics work correctly. Okay. First, I want to give you a brief little history of how we got here. You know, as everybody knows, it's been a year ago this past September that the prior executive director of BARTA, Dennis LaWorse, passed away unexpectedly. And at that time, I was contacted by the BARTA Board of Directors, because if you didn't know it, I used to work at BARTA a couple times, actually. So I was pretty familiar with their operation, and they asked if I could help out. And I said I'd be more than willing to, and so did the board of directors at Red Rose Transit. And it was an initial six-month contract that PennDOT helped pay for the added services. And pretty close to the end of the 6 months, we got the two board of directors together at a joint board retreat to try to figure out what should be the future direction for BARTA and Red Rose. Because as many of you know, PennDOT's been looking at a big consolidation study. In fact, they're calling it the South Central Regional Transportation Consolidation Study. That was a 9-county area. And we thought, well, if PennDOT's pushing for this, it's something that we should take into consideration. So at the joint board retreat, we basically had three options that were presented to both boards. One was to hire a new executive director for BARTA. Second was to continue the management contract. And third was to explore merging the two systems. And at the time, the two boards felt that it was worth exploring, and they formed a joint board committee comprised of two members from each board and an alternate. And Commissioner Barnhardt served on that, as well as Tim Snyder, who's here today as part of the BARTA board. And the alternate was Michael Roberg. And this joint board committee met for a couple of months. And one of the things they looked at very detailed was both operations in their entirety. In fact, I have a notebook here. This big white one that's about 5 inches thick is everything you ever wanted to know about Red Rose or BARTA. It has everything in there. All the policies, all the contracts, the audits, the operating data. So everything that they needed to know about the two agencies and how they operated was included in these big notebooks that were given to each one of the members of this committee. And that was, the first task was to decide, after doing what we would call the due diligence period, to make a decision whether or not it should be pursued, to merge or not to merge. And it was in July that both boards passed resolutions to further explore the merger. So the decision was made that it made sense, made economical sense to merge the two agencies. And then after that decision was made, the Joint Board Committee met regularly again. And this is just some of the background information that they were looking at, how both transit authorities were organized, what their combined budgets are, federal apportionments, state funding, local matches, the size of the fleets, the facilities. And I know it's, I apologize, it's a very small chart, but what it is all the operating data for all the urban systems in Pennsylvania. Because one of the things that the boards really were interested in is how did we stack up, and you know, where did the two agencies fit in relation to everybody else around the state? So this is kind of a summary chart, and it shows that a combined agency would basically be ranked either third or fourth on many of the parameters, either third on budget, fourth on passengers, fourth on a couple other measures, but just shows you how they stood up. So after doing all this work, and I want to commend both the boards because they really did put in a lot of time. The Joint Board Committee has met, you know, 4 o'clock every other week for a long time, going through all this stuff in great detail. And I can say the one thing that was always on their minds is, if this is going to work, how can we save taxpayers money? Because that was one of the sole goals of this merger. So after looking at all this, we came up with a recommended structure where BARTA and RTA would consolidate the management administrative services of the two authorities. So both BARTA and RTA will remain as operating entities. So the drivers and mechanics at both agencies will remain employees of both agencies, but the administrative employees and the management people would all move to the new authority. And then we had to look at, well, if this happens, how would we comprise the board? And the recommendation was that right now both the boards are 9 members, BARTA and Red Rose both have 9 members, that we would reduce that to 5 members from each county. And then that would comprise the new proposed authority, which would be the South Central Transit Authority. But then the 5 representatives from Berks County would also serve as the board of directors for BARTA, and the 5 representatives from Lancaster would serve as the board of directors for Red Rose. Because with the two operating agencies still being in existence, you still needed to have 2 separate boards to deal with the business of those authorities. And then BARTA and Red Rose would contract with the new authority for the management administrative services. And like I said, the goal at the very beginning, and this is because of Act 89, which was the new transportation bill passed in 2013, there's a provision in the bill that allows that if counties want to consider consolidating transit authorities, any of the savings that they get will be offset by their local match. So in other words, whatever savings we get, that's that much less that either Berks County or Lancaster County would have to pay in the local match. Right now, both counties are required to pay a local match for our state funding under Act 44. It requires 15% of the amount that you're getting. If you're not at the 15% level, then you have to increase it 5% a year until you reach that level. But you can see right now, the level for Berks County is $483,318. The level for Lancaster was $297,502 for a combined local match of $780,820. And that's been our target from the very beginning. That was the goal, was to see if we could get enough savings to match the local match that was being provided by both counties. So for the 5 years, either county would not have to pay a local match. So at the end of that 5 years, Berks County would save $2.8 million and Lancaster would save $1.7 million, or a combined $4.5 million from not having to pay the local match. So as we went through this exercise and we went through all the books and everything, we started coming up with areas that we could save. And the non-staffing areas amounted to about $174,000 of things that, you know, we would only need one solicitor since it would be a combined boards. We're able to take some advantages of economies of scale. We recently awarded a joint parts procurement bid for bus parts where we saved over $80,000 by combining the two entities together in the bid. And then we looked at duplication of staffing. And we came up with 7 to 8 positions that basically could be eliminated through duplication of efforts at a cost of about $656,000. So the total savings right now is $830,000, which is more than the combined local match. So over the 5-year time period, we would save over $4.7 million of taxpayers' money from both counties not having to pay the local match. And like I said, the recommended authority structure that's recommended by the Joint Board Committee and both boards, both counties would save their local match for 5 years. After the 5 years, the local match would be split 50-50 between the two counties, and they would pick up, the local match would basically be frozen for that entire 5-year time period. So after 5 years, the local match would remain at $780,820 and then increase from there until we reach the 15% level. And then the new authority headquarters would be at Red Rose Transit, and that was because of the healthcare consortium that we belong to. There's two public consortiums. One is just Lancaster and York counties, and the other one is all the counties surrounding Lancaster and York. Well, the way this we're proposing the structure, we could add the administrative employees from BARTA directly into the consortium that Red Rose now belongs to and save about $30,000 or more from doing that. And then the new authority would become the designated recipient for all the federal funds and state operating funds. And as you heard, the new name would be the South Central Transit Authority. And structurally, this is kind of how it would look. Both existing BARTA and RTA would contract with the new authority for management services, and then the management services would take care of all the daily operations at each of the authority. And then the timetable, this is all the steps that we've gone through, and as you can see today, we're at the county commissioner's meeting for requesting final approval to form the new authority. And that's about it. Anybody has any questions? I'd be happy to answer them.
Any questions or comments from my colleagues?
I have some questions for Mr. Kilmer. First of all, I want to thank Mr. Kilmer. We've had a number of conversations over the past several months, and he's been very helpful in providing me with information that was intended to better inform me so I can make an informed decision. There's been a significant change since the original concept was rolled out, and that was based on correspondence that I've seen in part in response to some acrimonious or statements or saber rattling, if you will, from certain union officials. So what was going to be a consolidation of two authorities into one is now the formation of a holding company super authority that has two subsidiary authorities with whom it contracts. So now we have three authorities instead of two. So that the efficiency of that seems counterintuitive, but I can't quibble with what's being put on the table. What's concerning to me is that this be an opportunity, and my support would be contingent upon this, that this be an opportunity to experiment with the availability of savings and not bind us to decades of a structure from which we can't withdraw. If the savings don't materialize, if service would somehow become inefficient, cumbersome, we had complaints from the public, et cetera. And it seems to me that although the holding company configuration is a little more cumbersome. It affords us, I think, the opportunity both for Lancaster and for Berks to withdraw and to dissolve this arrangement if for some reason it becomes not as productive as we had thought. And that is very much attractive to me. So the questions I have for you, sir, is to whom do these subsidies get paid? Right now, the counties contribute, based on a pie chart, about 6% of the subsidies.
Correct.
The rest is from federal and state. What's really interesting is the contributor of 6% is driving the whole reconfiguration of these organizations. And so, and it's an interesting observation, I think, to make, that in order for us to say this kind of money over 5 years, you'd basically have to dissolve these authorities or make them profitable and have no subsidies whatsoever, which is not in the cards.
No.
So the only opportunity to save $2.8 million, allegedly, over 5 years for Berks County is to go into this kind of arrangement, even though we're only contributing right now 6%.
Right.
So if we didn't have this merger, to save any kind of money, any kind of savings would only flow to us at 6 cents on the dollar. If we $1 savings for the new work for BARTA, if it became more efficient, would save the county 6 cents. So it's interesting that we're the drivers of the merger, but we're really the smallest of all the contributors. So the subsidy payments that come from federal, state, and county, to whom would they be paid under the new arrangement? Would they go to BARTA, and then BARTA, pursuant to its contract with South Central, would mail a check in to South Central, or does it go directly to South Central?
The way it would be structured, it goes directly to South Central.
Okay. Now, the length of the contract that for management services, I haven't seen a pro forma on that, and maybe it exists, maybe it doesn't. Does it exist? Do we have an idea of what this management contract will look like?
It hasn't been drafted yet.
Well, that's a concern. I mean, I would want to have termination provisions and a duration of that contract that are such that, and I'm not trying to be a cynic here, but I've been in government long enough to know that anything that can go wrong will go wrong. Murphy's Law is no more applicable anywhere in the world than in government. So if we had a termination provision and a length of initial term of, say, 3 years or something during which this can prove itself out, I would be happier with that. I'm going to assume that for purposes of argument that that's going to be incorporated into the documents.
And I think that's one of the advantages, actually, of having both the existing authorities continue to exist as operating entities, so that if, say, 3 years from now, what you say comes true, it'd be easy to dissolve the new authority. The remaining authorities are still in existence. No harm, no foul, so to speak.
Well, that's much more desirable, in my view, than the previous. And I want to thank the people who were acrimonious in Lancaster County for providing the opportunity to have this new structure that eases the withdrawal and makes it more flexible for Berks County.
There was, in fact, going to be an existing BART and Red Rose authority, a legacy authority, to deal with any kind of claims or anything that came forward. So they were still going to be there in form and function, but not as active as they will be in the future.
They wouldn't be up. They would have been basically on paper, not active operating agencies.
Correct.
So either way, we would
not eliminated either.
Not eliminated.
Right. Either way, we would have had the ability to go back, so to speak, if needed to.
I have some other thoughts, but I think I'll reserve them. I think I've spoken enough. We'll let other people speak if they'd like.
Any comments?
Sure. I would like to make the motion to approve resolution number 349-14 and resolution number 350-14 and thank the boards of both Red Rose and BARTA. Thank the board of Lancaster County Commissioners and the Berks County Commissioners. As Dave pointed out in his presentation, been working diligently at this since April. We had some contentious discussions and some back and forth, but not so much with Lancaster, but I think internally with our BARTA folks. But I think what came out of here is really a benefit to not just the taxpayers. The riders get a benefit, more efficiency down the road, because keep in mind, this formation of this management authority will save money for the counties, but it also saves money for the authority. And once year six comes around, that money gets replenished into the account of South Central Transit from both counties. So that will help us to expand routes, to do more for the folks that ride the buses in year six and beyond. And these numbers are not allegations or alleged numbers. These are true factual numbers that have been dealt with and approved by the federal and state governments. It's going to be a difficult situation for us because we're going to be losing a minimum of three people at both agencies through through this merger and through the attrition. But again, this is a regional effort, and we always hear government's bloated, overrun. We got to find more efficient and better ways to run government. Here's an effort on behalf of both counties and both of their transit agencies to come up with something that's a regional approach. And we selected South Central in a poll, South Central Transit Authority. We didn't want to struggle with how do we put in Berks, how do we put in Lancaster, how do we go back and forth, and who was first, who was last. But it also gives us that opportunity for, again, regional thought. And Scott Martin from Lancaster County, one of their commissioners, made the comment yesterday that there's already a buzz out there in the community that this may exactly, may potentially create one of the other agencies that are connected to South Central to want to sit down and discuss a potential merger of sorts with us as well. So again, the cost savings are obvious. The savings coming out of this actually then benefits, and I want to thank Tim Snyder, one of our board members, this was his brilliant idea. The match is not balanced going in. We pay more than Lancaster County as a local match. Coming out of it in year six, it's a 50-50 split. So not only do we save the money in the first 5 years, we get the benefit of coming out as an equal partner in year six and beyond. And again, those numbers and that savings can certainly be used for expansion of service. So I think there's winners all around. And obviously the 10 members of the board, five from Lancaster, five from Berks, are really charged with a pretty monumental task of making sure these numbers are true, they're accurate, and we're going to hold ourselves accountable for these numbers going forward. You know, to me, it's akin to the clean and green rollback taxes. You know, PennDOT says, hey, we're going to forgive you of your local match, but if you violate that, I'm sure they may want to come back and charge us penalty and interest on the money we're trying to save. So we all are very mindful of the numbers and what we're looking at. And I want to commend the folks who run the joint committee. Tim Snyder's here this morning. Mickey Roberg's not here. Jim Schlegel's here from the BARTA board, two very interested participants. And even though we had met meetings that Jim was able to attend, we wanted to make sure we weren't violating the Sunshine Law. But Tim and I hopped in the car every other week and went to Lancaster, and every other week we went to BARTA and had meetings and found the people in Lancaster are extremely cordial, open-minded, and very proactive, and they were very supportive of this from the beginning.
If I could add, too, that
Just one second for the purpose of continuity here. We have a motion. We need a second.
I will second the motion, but I would hasten to add that there should be an opportunity for public comment prior to the vote, because if we do not, it will be an invalid public hearing.
That's exactly what I'm trying to do here, so... I'm glad for the second. If we can hold off, Dave, for a minute, I'd like to open it up to anyone from the public that would like to make a comment, address the issue. Ralph?
I apologize. I didn't see anybody raise their hand.
Yeah, it's okay. Mary, make sure he can get back through there. Up to the microphone, and if you could pull the mic down for him. Yeah, Ralph Trainer and I sit on a committee together up in Harrisburg, the Long-Term Care Commission, so we see each other fairly often.
Mr. Kellner, my question is in regards to services for people with disabilities.
Mm-hmm. I know how BARTA handles it. I think they handle it very well compared to other transportation agencies across the state. And also as a member of PennDOT's Shared Ride Commission, I sit on that and I hear about the mergers and so forth. Some of the mergers sound good for people with disabilities. Others, there's a disconnect. How do you see Lancaster's connection, Red Rose's connection with BARTA supporting people with disabilities, and are there going to be expanded services?
Well, right now, we actually provide service into Berks County from Lancaster for some clients that need to go to services that are in Berks County. And if you weren't aware, the shared ride service in Red Rose is actually about 1.5 times larger than the service in Berks County. We've always operated as a brokerage-type service in Lancaster for over 30 years. And our service is all contracted out, and we have 70 vehicles, which is even more than what Reading has. But it will definitely allow more opportunities, because one of the things that we're both going to be doing pretty close to the same time is the state has this new shared ride software that they paid for. It's called EcoLane. And we're both going to be merging to that at pretty close to the same time. So we're going to have a central database for both counties and a central call center for both counties. And the nice thing is the service in Lancaster is all contracted out. And as you know here, part of it is contracted out, part of it's provided directly. But I think that's going to give some opportunities to have some better efficiencies, because if we have somebody that, say, is close to either border, because we're actually using the same private entity as a contractor in both counties, we can provide those trips, I think, more efficiently and at a lower cost than we could with the current structure. So I think there's going to be some opportunities, and I think the state's hoping that, I think as part of this, that's one of the pluses that's going to come out is kind of the expansion of the shared ride service, particularly for people with disabilities.
In Red Rose, are all your fixed route buses accessible?
Yes, they are.
Yep. Do you see expansion of fixed route services as well?
You know, we got asked that at the very beginning, and I had people even come up to me and say, oh, I can't wait till I can catch a bus to the city of Reading from Lancaster or vice versa. But the one thing that we always have to keep in mind, it has to make economic sense to provide that service. And right now, we haven't seen any of the numbers that show that it would make economic sense. And we're not going to just add service for the sake of adding service, because funding is limited. But in the future, you know, as we look as both counties continue to grow, and my guess is by the next census, they're going to combine the two urbanized areas easily, because we're just about there now.
Well,
there's going to be more opportunities.
My hope is that if the merger does go through, it will provide more opportunities for people with disabilities to go from Reading to Lancaster and vice versa. There is a need for transportation for people with disabilities more and more.
Yeah, that's great. You. And you know me, Rob. Anytime you got an idea, just give me a call.
We'll do.
Yeah, we worked together well last time I was here.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you, Ralph. Anyone else that would like to make a comment specifically regarding the proposed merger? Okay, seeing no comment, any additional comments from my colleagues?
Yes, just a few. One of my concerns here has been performance and accountability, and I think that that's been at least partially addressed by the ability per contract of the BARTA board to hold the holding company accountable for performance. And I have a lot of confidence in Mr. Kilmer. He's been a great asset already. But we have that protection built in by virtue of the management contract. I would have liked to have seen consideration of, if there is one, private management of the two authorities, because frankly, we employ that model at Berksheim, and we've done so with great success. Private managers who compete for an opportunity to provide managerial service have shown, from our experience at the Heim, a great deal of entrepreneurial thinking, more than I think existed prior to our hiring there, and is responsible for the fact that Berksheim continues to operate in the black. I'm concerned that the merger, and now that it's a holding company, it's not as strong of a so-called merger, would have opened the door for union demands to match the highest level of benefits and wages in both counties, where everything would rise to the highest level, and that those demands, if met, would offset to a large extent or maybe completely, the $800,000 annual proposed savings. That remains to be seen whether there are any costs associated with the consolidation in the holding company's operation that will offset the savings. I suspect there may be some unanticipated expenses that will diminish the magnitude of the savings, but we'll see. Last thing I want to see is the creation of a miniature SEPTA. I think the history of SEPTA as a regional transportation authority has been colorful. I put it in the most positive light. I could say other things. I think other of my colleagues share the same view, and we want to guard against that. I'm also mindful of the fact that those board members who are going to attend meetings will have to travel to Lancaster. That's a much longer commute than it is right now to attend board meetings, and I don't believe the members receive compensation. So I hope that they enjoy their one-hour trek to downtown Lancaster, as opposed to the 20 minutes or whatever it takes to get to the BARTA headquarters. And that's just a human factor that I think is in play. With those reservations, I'm going to be supportive, but I'm also going to be looking to see the performance actually materializes. I don't want to, it's very difficult for me as a commissioner to turn aside the opportunity to save $2.8 million over 5 years. Our budget director would not be happy with that. But there are intangibles. It's not always just about money. There's performance and there's accountability, and those things have to be preserved. And I think the new structure addresses, at least in part, those concerns. So that's what I have to say.
One note, the board meetings are not going to be an issue because they switch back and forth from one county to the other. So the pain will be equally shared. You might say it's split 50-50, which listening to this conversation kind of reminds me of the difference between old-fashioned traditional marriage where till death do us part and modern-day prenup. I think largely what we're hearing is almost a prenup. Just in case it doesn't work out, we have this back door here and this back door there. It might make actually a lot more sense in dealing with a decision like this. But a couple things I want to share. Number one, we have a year plus experience of joint management. And Dave Kilmer has run a flawless operation. How do we know? Because I haven't heard anything. And believe me, when you have two separate organizations and multiple unions, if there were problems, we would hear about it. In government, and I think it's this way in a lot of places, no news is good news. It's when people have problems, they tend to come forward and tell you. It's kind of rare that somebody says, hey, I wanted to call today and tell you things are great at BARTA. But that's number one. We have a track record of joint, not necessarily operations, but working together and and under the leadership of Dave Kilmer that's been very positive. Number two, the savings cannot be ignored. And the savings really occur for Berks County on two fronts. Number one, they occur because of 5 years, and it's an incentive put on the table by PennDOT to encourage mass transit to look at more cooperation and more regionalization. But that $2.8 million is real money. I also talked to our CFO and wanted to have his read on what he thought, and he believes in everything that he has seen that this is real money. I might add a little caveat here. ATU tried to blow up this deal. That is one of the unions. And I believe as of a week or so ago, they thought this was done, that their decision to say, hey, we aren't going to agree to what we, in essence, had agreed up until now, and you're not going to be able to move forward now unless you give us what we want. Well, I have to give credit to Dave, to Commissioner Barnhardt, to Tim Snyder, to the board members from Red Rose. I think they came up with a very good solution, and that's a positive thing. So the savings jointly, we save over the first 5 years. For Berks County, one of the concerns, from my perspective, Dave, was that we're putting more cash on the table, we're putting in a little bit larger system, and we currently pay a greater dollar amount in our match. And my question several months ago, I believe, to you was, what happens after the 5 years? By going to 50-50, the county, Berks County, effectively, will be paying less in our match at the end of 5 years than we were paying before. So we have an ongoing savings stream beyond just the savings that occurs from the five years. Finally, I believe that we've already been able to demonstrate some efficiency just by having one person running both operations. Now we have an opportunity to merge our management team in a formal way, and I believe that's going to bring true long-term savings. The commitment I make is to continue to be vigilant as a commissioner representing one of the two counties in the partnership. If things don't go as advertised, I will be there asking questions, challenging our board members, challenging Dave Kilmer to say, what's going on? Why is this taking place? But everything I've seen has been very positive, and I strongly support this merger. I think it is good for both counties, but more importantly, I believe it is good for the taxpayers, and I believe it will be better in an overall system for the riders and customers of the new joint organization. Any other comments before we call the vote? Hearing none, all those in favor of the motion, and if you want to reiterate the motion, because there's a couple of pieces.
We'd have to turn my...
You got to turn your iPad back on.
Oh, here it is. Okay. Move to approve resolution 349-14, approving the amendment of the Articles of Incorporation of Berks Area Regional Transportation Authority to be effective January 1, 2015. And adoption of resolution 35-14, approving the new joint transit authority to be known as South Central Transit Authority.
Instead of 35, we'll call that 350, right?
350-14.
Okay,
right.
Got it.
Dot, dot, dot.
Any other discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor signify by saying aye.
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 Opposed? The motion is carried.
Thank you.
Thank you very much, Dave. Thank you for those that came out for the hearing. A couple of the BARTA board members that we have here as well. We appreciate it. And you're welcome to stick around for the next exciting steps in our show here. We'll go from one presentation to another. This is the presentation of our draft 2015 budget, and I'd like to recognize our Chief Financial Officer, Mr. Bob Patrizio. Are you ready?
Thank you, Commissioners. It's my privilege to once again present the annual county budget, in this case for 2015. As you know, we started this process in the middle of January this year with weekly budget meetings. That was followed by a formal budget kickoff with all our department heads in April. And at that time, we presented to all the department heads with the combined approval of our COO, Carl Gefkin, the Commissioner's 2015 budget objectives. Those objectives were no property tax increase for 2015, balanced operating budget without using reserves, if at all possible, hold wage and expenditure growth to projected CPI, reduce headcount wherever possible, reduce overtime, no new unfunded discretionary programs, fund new facility infrastructure needs with reserves as opposed to debt service, maintain commitment to farmland preservation, education, economic development, transportation, library system, eliminate non-core services wherever possible, and maintain our long-term financial stability and our bond rating. So how did we do? I'm once again very pleased to present a budget that does not recommend a tax increase for 2015. Our recommendation is that we'll maintain the current 2014 millage rate of 7.372 mils. With respect to the budget, we almost got to a balanced budget. We have a deficit that we're recommending of 3.2 million, but a big piece of that is one-time capital expenditures of 6.5 million. But for that, we'd actually be presenting a budget that had a surplus of 3.3 million. Again, the use of the surplus or reserves for capital allows us to maintain our very low direct issue bond debt, and also helps us avoid recurring annual new debt service cost. So I think that's a good thing, and that's our recommendation. With respect to wage increases, we have a range of 2 to 2.5% with CPI projected at 2%. The majority is projected at 2%, however. The only rates we have in 15 that are higher than that are pursuant to collective bargain labor agreements. For example, Berksheim that were negotiated 4 years ago, they're at the 2.5%, and we have about 31 employees under a collective bargain agreement that actually at 3% in 15. But that was in exchange for getting a wage freeze in 13 through binding arbitration, which for us was very successful at the time. As far as the overtime budget, we're still recommending we keep the budget dollars at 4.9 million. Our COO, with the approval of the board, put in a formal overtime policy effective July 1, and we are seeing a favorable trend with actual paid overtime for 2013 versus 2014. We're running in the range of about 300,000 less year to date on a projected basis versus last year, but a one-quarter trend at this point. I'm just not comfortable pulling that number down yet, but I am hopeful with the efforts that our COO and our HR department, in particular our director of HR, are with the spotlight focused on overtime and the reasons for overtime and trying to pull that back, that a year from now we'll be able to pull that number down. With respect to headcount, I think you have to look at two things. If you look at the first bullet and you look at 10.5 positions eliminated, and then you look at the next bullet, the expansion of our federalized residential family center program, if you look at we added 17 positions and we eliminated 10.5, it appears that we added headcount of 6.5, which we did. And we look like we didn't achieve the goal, but really we did achieve the goal because the 17 positions at the federal ICE program are 100% fully funded by the feds, totally contingent on their program, their willingness to fund those positions. And the day that they don't want that many employees because they don't want to pay for them is the day those positions are eliminated. So they will never cost the county a nickel. So take the focus back up to the 10.5 positions. So in reality, we did achieve the goal because the other positions are contingent on funding and always funded. The highlights of that, 7 positions were eliminated because we repatriated back to the state the in-home services programming and waiver, or in-home services programming and aging called waiver. We also outsourced 3 positions for community development to our redevelopment authority because we found that to be a more efficient service delivery model. And that actually has the benefits when you do that of overtime, reducing your exposure to higher pension costs and higher self-insured health insurance costs. We had a handful of other one-off eliminations of positions recommended in this budget. One was actually in our department. It was our former human services coordinator. We were able to consolidate that work into other departments. We're also recommending the elimination of the ag coordinator position. We do have to add a couple positions, though, particularly 2 in children youth services because of the reaction to the Jerry Sandusky child abuse case. Has resulted in significant new regulation that it will be effective January 1 of 2015 in CYS, and they actually project, after having done, going back and reviewed intake cases that they looked at, that they would probably have had to investigate 22% more of those calls than they did. And as a result, we had to increase their expenditure budget, and we also have revenue, and it was an incremental match impact we'll talk about a little later. But bottom line is we have to add two positions, and then we're going to track it and see what really happens. We also had to add three positions back into the court budget because the current governor of Pennsylvania appointed a judge to a vacant judgeship position we had, and therefore we had to fund the judicial staff and put that back into the budget. But they're really the highlights of headcount. Great news is we were able to lower our debt service by $1 million by refinancing our 2008 and our 2010 A bonds. We had a very limited window to do that in September, October. Municipal, short-term municipal, medium-term and long-term municipal tax-exempt rates really declined in response to what was going on in the stock market. Because we're very fluid, the board is very fluid, and we react, because we have weekly budget meetings, we're able to react to that very quickly and make a timely decision to refinance this debt. And the benefit is going to be we're going to realize at least $1 million of savings. That is reflected as a highlight in the budget. We also have a lower pension cost. Our pension cost budget for 2015 is $1.3 million. That is $1 million lower than the budget for 2014. That's real savings. I would add that a lot of our success here is because we pre-funded our pension plan in December of 2012, which really had an immediate benefit in 13 and 14. And over 2 years, that has provided real dollar savings in our year-over-year budgets on an aggregate basis, just for 2 years, of $9.2 million, and that's significant. And a big reason why we can recommend the budget once again of not having a tax increase. Elimination of BARTA, you just talked about it. I don't think I need to say more about that. I totally agree. It's $2.8 million over 5 years. It's real money. I also believe when we come out of that, Commissioner Barnhardt, was the combined match there $780,000?
Correct.
So, you know, we're looking at a match coming out of this at $390,000 in the sixth year. Jen, we'll have to add that as an adjustment to the forecast next year, coincidentally. And then it grows at 5%. So we're coming out of the box. We're at about $500,000 now. 6 years from now, we're at least $110,000 lower in the sixth year than we are what we would have been in 15 had we not, the board not had approved this merger today. So I thank you for that. I think the taxpayers will thank you for that. And hopefully Commissioner Scott's concerns will be abated with the actual performance. We also maintain the following commitments to farmland preservation. It's a big goal to commissioners, $1 million for new certifications. That enables us to maximize state and federal funding. Our RAC commitment, $3.1 million operating, $750,000 in capital for 15 for renovations to, I think it's their building called Berks Hall. Mm-hmm. It's interesting, that would have been funded through the county directly. But because we outsourced the community development program to redevelopment authority, we'll get the money, we pass it through, and the redevelopment authority will actually write that check using community development block grant money to RAC. So we, on our budget, it looks like they're lower, but in reality, they're actually at the same rate or higher than they were a year ago. We maintain our contribution to the greater Reading Economic Partnership, $500,000. We still provide a $200,000 match on non-grant revenue that they raise. That is going to expire December 31st of 17, however. And what I mean by expire is the match piece. The board is totally committed to maintaining the $500,000 block grant funding for the economic development effort. Library system, we still maintain our support to the library system with net tax revenues. And that $3.4 million is actually $100,000 higher than it was in the 14 budget. As far as our efforts to eliminate non-core operations, again, we made a decision to transition back to the state, the waiver program. You know, what really forced this is the state, year over year, was cutting the amount of money they were going to provide for our effort in this area. And we determined with the leadership of our COO that there was a more efficient way to deliver that service. So we're not, the aging waiver in-home service is not being eliminated. That service is still available in Berks County. It's going to be invisible to those that need it, but we're not going to be providing the service. It's back to the state, and the state will decide who's going to provide that service by contract locally. I don't believe for a second the Board of Commissioners would have supported this if they thought there would have been any negative impact on the quality of that service locally. And I know our COO does not believe that is even a possibility. So that's that. Community development, we talked about that. And parks. Karcher Creek, I don't think we wanted to walk away from Karcher Creek, but the state game lands was, or the
fish and boat.
Fish and boat just wasn't willing to yield any kind of, meet our requirements for continue to do that, and we were willing to do it. But as a result, that's out. And Hunziker Grove, we're in the process of transitioning that active park to a township. And what that really does is allows us to really become micro-focused, laser-focused on Antietam Park, which is in acres, you know, the largest park system
Bob,
we have.
Just one caveat. Karcher Creek is still, there's still negotiations going on.
Okay.
So just.
Yep. Yep. That's not something that we intend to, we would like to be involved.
Correct.
Absolutely.
Yes. Moody's has reaffirmed just our, because we refinanced our debt, we had our bond rating reaffirmed for not only our 2014 bonds, which we've already priced and will be closing on Monday, but also our 2015 bonds, which we'll be pricing next week and closing in early January, but that's very favorable for us. Capital plan highlights, you have a total plan. I like to just focus you there at the bottom, $25.9 million. What's really interesting is that number a year ago was $50.7 million, and the decline is because we've completed, just recently completed our 911 new radio system. We completed the renovations to this building in the parking garage. The renovations to the courthouse are substantially completed. We completed the demolition of the old Heim building, which coincidentally helped us reduce our maintenance cost and our utility cost. We completed the demolition of the old Heim annex. So we had a lot of projects we talked about last year that were going to be completed in 14 that were. And as a result, we're starting to get on the other side of that curve that started 3 years ago, which is huge escalating capital budgets. I mean, I think if you go back, I think it was 2012, it was like $70 million, this number. Big, primarily because of 911 at that point. Some of the highlights, I'm just going to pick out a select few here. Go ahead, Kim, bring them all up. Because a lot of this you can read in the detailed budget message, but you know, when I look at this, we're on the downside on the prison projects. We still got a significant portion of that $4.1 million is for the security system, cameras. It's going to give us a, you know, when you're talking about our focus for the last 3-4 years has been on efficiency, it's going to give us efficiency in the jail with those cameras, and it's going to give us better protection for not only the inmates but also our inmates. We're continuing building repairs. We got facilities. You know, you're finally, we've contracted for the elevator upgrades on all our buildings. So that's $800,000. Trestle Bridge is actually in the agenda today. I didn't realize that. We're just slightly under the $700,000 budget. Bridges, not going to enumerate that, but we're working on just a number of bridge projects that are funded with liquid fuels. Technology upgrade, $1 million, sand replacement. This is just stuff that we need to do. But what's interesting is the board made a very smart decision a month ago based on the recommendation of our IS director with the support of our COO to move the Microsoft 360. I'm not going to try to explain all that right now, but suffice it to say, that decision reduced that number by $900,000. In other words, if the board had not decided to do that, the budget there for IS would be $1.9 million. So that's cost avoidance, and that's a real good decision for us. Parks, continued emphasis on Antietam. And Angora Fruit Farm is part of Antietam. So, you know, you're looking at spending another $2.4 million in 15 on building out the improvements that were planned out several years ago. The majority of that, if not all of that, is funded by Act 13 shale money. We'll have to stay tuned to see what the new governor, the depending what kind of support the new governor gets with the legislature in Harrisburg, what will happen to that shale money? Because if you impose an excise tax on the extraction of oil and natural gas on the wells, I don't know what will happen with those impact fees that were imposed, which get half of that, or some percentage of that, I think it's near half, gets distributed to all the counties. And we use it to fund parks and also bridge work. Go ahead, Kim, why don't you go to the next slide? Fund balance highlights, go ahead, Kim, just click them all up. We continue our restriction, it's legal restriction. Hazmat money comes with funding that is legally restricted to use. And what you have, and what we think we're going to have at the end of 15 is about 1.5 million more in receipts that in that program than expenditures. So that's legally restricted. What that means is we just can't spend that on any general government programming. Great news, no more assignment for Berksheim. Commissioner Scott alluded to the CHR management, and it's been really outstanding. But when I started, we had a cumulative aggregate loss at the Heim. I think it was the end of 2004, might have been the end of 2005, over in excess of $10 million. You have to set aside your general fund reserves for those losses. And we did. And at the end of 14, we no longer have cumulative losses at Berksheim. Matter of fact, I think it was the final results for 13, it actually went positive. So that's gone now, and that's because since 2006, we've been break-even or better, and in the last 4 years, mm-hmm. under the leadership of CHR, we've had just significant net income results. And you know, it's just huge in our ability not to have to raise taxes every year. I mean, that's just big, big for us. Wastewater treatment plant, it's in the to-be-determined list. It's on the high-priority capital plan. It's not in the capital plan yet because we're still working out what needs to be done there, but that plan has not been upgraded in several years, including the sewage treatment lines that run into it. So we've set, actually, this money came from the Solid Waste Authority a year ago, and with a designation attached to it that it's for the upgrade of that plant, so we have to set that aside. Route 22 corridor, $5 million, I call that kind of incentive or enticement money to get the state to include into the transportation plan the expansion of 222 North, not just the roundabouts, but also the widening of the project. If we're going to spend that money, it's going to be spent before the end of 2018. We continue our assignment of $4 million for health care costs. If we end up with very high volume of large claims, but not so large that they pierce the level of our stop-loss insurance. So we set that aside just in case that were to happen. Cumulative losses, this is new. We have to assign now for cumulative losses at 911. I'm going to get into a slide that explain that more in detail, but suffice it to say, now that the new radio system has come online, all the costs associated with that new radio system are now going to be recognized in our emergency 911 fund. And it's going to generate a loss and losses that grow. So like Berksheim, if you have cumulative losses, you had to set aside general fund balance. Same thing's going to apply to 911. And with respect to unassigned fund balance, and this is what the rating agencies like, we're projecting that number to be $130.5 million at the end of 15. That's a $2.5 million increase from where we think it's going to be at the end of 14. And the reasons for that are, we've touched on some of it already, lower debt service, lower pension cost, higher net income for BCRC. So this is the aggregation of those highlights are all included in these numbers. And what I'd like to focus you on right now is just general fund 2015 column. You have revenues 215.5, expenditures 202.8. It's interesting. County code only requires us to put forward a budget that's for the general fund expenditures. And we're only required to enact a resolution that establishes the tax rate. Matter of fact, Commissioner Barnhardt showed me yesterday Lancaster County's budget, and that's all they put forward to their taxpayers. But our board likes to be transparent, and I totally agree with that. So we budget all funds, and we open the books up to the citizens of the county to understand everything that can potentially affect their taxes.
Did you just say Lancaster County's not transparent?
No, I said that we're more transparent.
More transparent. Okay.
But Bob's becoming a politician.
Yeah.
We're more transparent.
And what makes it more interesting, you're from Chester County.
We're more transparent than they are, in my opinion, too. But they do more than, they present more information than Lancaster County does, for sure. But anyway, it's interesting because they are doing what county, there's nothing wrong with what they do. They do what county code says you have to do. We decide to enact a budget for all funds, which makes it just an extremely intensive time, intensive process for not only departments, but especially our budget team. It's a lot of work to do to actually stand here and present a budget that's cohesive for all funds. But anyway, $202.8 million expenditure budget for the general fund. I had to point that out because that's required by code. All funds, which includes the general fund, expenditures of $455.3 million. And you can see that the net deficit number I presented from all funds, by the way, that's before bond-funded capital expenditures because that has no impact on our deficit. Net deficit of $3.2 million. What I think is interesting, and I'm just going to spend 30 seconds on, is it was $4.8 million. It's lower. And if I'm a citizen or I'm a taxpayer or anybody even in the audience or department heads, I wonder why that's lower. It's because of things we just said. Lower debt service, lower pension, lower bar to match, higher BCRC net income from the expansion of that program. With respect to the changes, you know, you can see almost everything's a little lower with the exception we're almost break even on the revenues and all funds. You know, I would just direct the taxpayers, the citizens, and anyone listening, we're going to actually post out on our website today a detailed written budget message, and you can get all the gory details in the section that describes the changes in general fund in all funds, revenues, and expenses. But in the interest of time, I'm just going to move on from here, and if anybody wants to read that and has questions, we'd be, you know, certainly willing to answer the reasons. But, you know, suffice to say you have things that go up, you have things that go down. Obviously, aging went down in revenues and expenses. Community development went down in revenues and expenses, but CYS went up in revenue and expenses. So you got things moving all over the place. But I refer you to that message, and you get all the details. Included in that revenue number is our taxes. And what I'd like to focus you here on is, first of all, the bottom line. And I like to summarize what is net tax revenues. For me, you have to also look at what's the rate of appeals, what are your rate of appeals, and how successful are people having their taxes appealed. So I like to go to the net bottom line. And you can see we actually have about a $900,000 increase, or, you know, maybe a close to $1 million increase between 2015 and 2014, 135 versus, you know, 134 million or so. If you look at the line right above it, that's where tax refunds, we actually have improvement there, about $350,000, because we've seen this year the volume of our corporate and industrial appeals has declined. They were really high in 2009 and 10, and this number, if you go back to those years, was really high. So it's coming back down and it's lower, and I think that's really helped us this year. The line above it, total tax revenue, really is just the tax billing, your interims for properties coming online, and your tax claim revenue, which is when people don't pay on time, it goes to tax claim and you put liens in. Finally, the percentage change, if you can just look at that line, you had 0.36% growth in our assessed value base from 13 to 14, and we only had a one one-hundredth of a percent increase between 14 and 15 at 0.37%. I mean, I guess that's good. It grew one one-hundredth of a percent, but you're going to see when I get to the forecast, that really is creating a drag on our revenue in our forecast period, because a year ago, we were hoping that would be 0.65%. And when we get to this forecast, you're going to see I had to throttle back all those growth assumptions going out the next 4 years, because this didn't materialize. Top line, that's the millage rate, no change. This is always a good one. It tells you how those taxes are consumed. You know, I focus you on the big slices first. That be judicial and public safety. You combine those two percentages, you're at 50.4%. That's the exact same percentage as 2014. You know, what's in those two categories? You're looking at courts, district justices, district attorney, public defender, sheriff, clerk of courts, coroner. You're looking at APO, adult probation, juvenile probation, and the county jail. Any county government, that's going to be the majority of the consumption of their general fund tax revenue. The other thing I'd like to point out, though, debt service, $22.5 million.
That's 14%. That's 1% lower than it was in 14 because we were able to refinance our 2008-2014 bonds to a lower interest rate. And the other thing I'd like to point out on the right-hand side is emergency 911. While that's not a big slice of the pie, that's 1% higher than it was last year because of the new 911 radio system coming online. So what happens with the 2015 budget, which is built around our current services, our current service delivery methods and vehicles, and our current service demands? If that all stays the same, status quo, what will 15 become? What happens to our deficits? And if you look at the net deficit, you can see that what happens beginning in 17 is the deficit starts to grow. And that's primarily because we have a structural imbalance in our budget, and I think most counties do. And that is that we just spent a lot of time on the assessed value growth. This growth in our assessed value, which is the primary source of our non-grant revenues that fund operations that don't have grants, is our assessed values. And it's and when that's growing at 0.37, 0.52, 0.75, what happens is with inflation in your wages and your benefits, and with inflation in your core operating expenses, let's say CPI is at 2%, you can see that you're going to start to get separation between your revenues and your expenditures. And that's what you see happening in here. And what, when you see the number there that says tax equivalent percentage, what that means is that's not year over year 1.84, then another 3.26, and then another 7.5. All this is trying to show is what do you need in a percentage tax increase to get each one of these years to be balanced. So they're independent of one. That number is independent of the prior year. So for example, if we did a tax increase in 16 of 1.84%, then that number in 17 would be 1.5%. So that's how you have to interpret this slide. With respect to the numbers, for those people watching that are accountants, they might be going, I wonder why the revenues went down and expenditures went down between 16 and 17. That's a really good observation, and it's because we've done so much bridge work that's funded with liquid fuels in 15 and 16 that our anticipated budget of liquid fuel revenue and expenditures in 17 is significantly lower. And that's the reason why those two numbers are lower. And then it starts to grow from there. And when you look at the revenue growth, it's primarily tax revenues growing, interest income growing, and Berksheim revenues growing. You know, if I was going to highlight some things, the expenditures are growing primarily because personnel costs are growing, wages, healthcare costs. And in 18 and 19, bottom right bullet, for the first time, or the second from the bottom right bullet, ACA Cadillac tax, thank you, Kim, is included in 18-19, $1.2 million, $1.7 million. That is a cost that we are just not going to be able to avoid unless the Affordable Care Act is modified or repealed. Matter of fact, we even thought, well, we can just say we're going to put everyone on the exchange and pay for that. And the current president administration in Washington signed an order of some kind that said that we can't do that because we'll be penalized like millions of dollars more. So, you know, at some point when we're doing a property tax increase, that's going to be a reason why right there. Key assumptions in this, no tax increase. So, again, I already talked about this. This is just trying to show what happens if you don't have any incremental revenue. So, obviously, there's no tax increase built into those revenue numbers. Tax-based growth we talked about assumes that our current level of federal state funding does not go down. Obviously, if they cut us in mandated services, we'd have to eat that. We've been very successful with cuts so far in non-mandated services, like, say, in health choices or mental health disabilities, aging. We just cut the services. Service levels remain flat, no new headcount growth, no new debt. Average wage increases, no more than, you know, just for a forecast, no more than, hopefully less than, 2.5, 2.753. Again, our goal is to what's CPI, and if it's lower than that, then you know we're gonna work hard to try to come in lower than those numbers. But this is what it looks like on these assumptions. Healthcare trend 7 to 8%. Pension arc remains flat at 1.3 million, which means we could have to at least get 7.5% return on our investments year over year. Inflation on our operating costs doesn't grow greater than 2.5%. And I already talked about the Cadillac tax. And one thing I do want to point out is this does include in the revenue section an 18% increase in the 911 fees for municipalities. That's been a subject of discussion in the community. Certainly in 14 we did it. We did it again in 15, and it's built out through this entire forecast period. But we still have growing deficits. With respect to 911, I thought that it would be very interesting this year to really show the impact of that. Oh, well, no, I got ahead of myself. The tax revenue versus personnel costs. We talked about the structural imbalance. This really depicts it. You know, when you look at how your tax revenue is growing, which is the bottom line, and then you look at how your personnel costs are growing, based on those assumptions on the last page, you can see you start to get this separation. At some point, you run out of programs that you can cut or services that you can walk away from. And at some point, that structural imbalance, which grows in 19 to $33 million deficit, at some point you have to infuse new revenue into the organization to be able to reduce that delta. Now to 911. We talked a lot about 911 today. It's a big, big project that started the planning for that. I remember the first planning meeting for that in 2006. It's finally live the last week or so. But it is a huge cost driver for us. The commissioners have said over and over again, the county is going to pay a significant portion of that system, where municipalities pay a very small percentage of the impact of that system. And I think this really depicts that. If you look at 2013, we actually had, you know, a surplus in that fund, $1.9 million, primarily because of the way the accounting happens, because the 911 system, which has been built out for the last 4 years, hadn't been put in service yet. When you look at 14, now you're seeing the system come online. Now you're seeing the emergency 911 fund has to now pick up the interest on the debt. That was $48 million of debt that we consumed in this project, is now being reflected in 14, but only for half the year. The interest on that debt is $2 million a year. Because the system wasn't in service in May, the general fund still had to pay the debt service in May of this year. But in November, now that the system's in service, the emergency 911 system has to pay the debt service. So that's higher. You also had depreciation kicks in now that the system's in service. So you see a transition from net income to a net loss because we have to pick up the interest expense. When you go to 15, you're picking up the full interest expense. You're picking up the full depreciation on a $54 million new radio system. You're picking up the new system maintenance cost. It's like software. You buy new software, you got to pay 22% of the cost in annual maintenance cost. We got a new radio system. The old system was 20 years old. We have $1.6 million of new annual maintenance costs now that we have to pick up in this radio system. This generates losses now, $7.5 million, that decline just slightly as you go out through the forecast period, primarily because interest expense starts to decline on the debt. Two key takeaways here. One is, but for the loss in 15, 16, and 17, 7.5 to 7.1. Think back to the overall county forecast. We would not have forecasted deficits from all funds in 15, 16, and 17. But for this project. But for this project, we wouldn't even be talking about a potential tax increase before 2018. So, you know, commissioners made the decision, which I think was the right decision, that the county should pay for the cost of that project in terms of the infrastructure and the interest, which is manifested in interest expense, depreciation. Commissioners also said, though, that the 911 fees charged on telephone lines and cell phone lines, combined with billing to municipalities, their contribution, should pick up the operating cost. You don't see it here, but that's not happening. That's not happening in 14. We got a net operating loss before depreciation and interest, we project, of $1.4 million, in spite of an 18% increase to municipalities in their fee, their contribution in 14. And that grows to $2.1 million from operations in 2015, in spite of an 18% increase in the billing to municipalities. The key point, and you'll see it when I get to the end, and I won't talk about it then, I'm going to talk about it here. There's legislation in Harrisburg that raises the fee on telephone lines and cell phone lines from $1.25 to a minimum starting point of $2, indexed annually for inflation, that absolutely needs to be enacted for us to change the $2 million operating piece. There's nothing we can do about the depreciation and the interest, because we decided the county and the county property taxpayers should pay for that versus the municipalities and the municipality tax, county, you know, property taxpayers. But we need that legislation passed so we can wipe out that operating deficit. That would not only help, that will help the municipalities in a big way. Next. Berksheim. In October, I think it was 23rd of 2013, we did a budget presentation talking about the projection of the Heim. And I thought that it made really good sense to revisit this right now, because we've actually improved the footprint. If you look at the net income in Heim, and we talked about substantial net income in prior years, you can see 13 at 2.6 million actual. What's interesting about 14, commissioners, is that you got one, we're projecting 1.9 million. The budget was 800,000. So we're doing much better than we had budgeted. And again, we've talked about a lot of the reasons. The Heim really benefited from lower pension costs. The Heim really benefited from refinancing the 2008 bonds, because a substantial portion of that bond issue, which refunded the 1998 bonds, was for the construction of the new Heim. The Heim is benefiting from the energy conservation projects we've done, so we have lower utility costs. In our forecast at the time, we didn't think the federal government, with their woes, was going to give us any kind of rate increase in Medicaid rates. We actually got 1.7%, so we built that out in the forecast. That's been a real improvement. We've increased our private pay rates July 1 of 14 instead of waiting until the end of 14, which really had a nice impact in 14's projection. And we also came up with a bifurcated rate in the Heim for single, for private rooms versus for semi, what's the word called? Semi-private rooms, thank you. And so you see that building out into 15. But what happens is, if you think of the slide two slides ago where you have your revenues flat and your personnel costs are increasing, Heim's our biggest employer. So what you're seeing here with this decline over time is you got that structural imbalance that really impacts the Heim too. Because if the Medicaid rates stay at 1.7%, which is about 80% of the residents in the Heim, and our wages are growing at 2, 2.5, 2.75, and 3, and our benefit cost is growing at 7 to 8%, then you see the net income in the Heim starts to decline. The great news is, though, that a year ago we had a net loss in 2017, and that's been extended out now 2 years. Now, I caution everyone, that's great. As long as our annual required pension contribution for the county stays at $1.3 million, and as long as our wage increases don't exceed the maximums that I had on the assumptions, then this is what we're likely to realize. But it's still good news, I think. And the last point I would make is, as that net income is declining at the Heim, when you're looking out at 2016, 17, and 18, well, with that decline in net income, what happens in the macro budget, the macro forecast, is you start to see an increase in the deficits overall, because the Heim's a big operation, like 911. So it's something eventually, you know, we might have to pick up some property tax if there isn't an alternative way to run this Heim, to subsidize some losses eventually. But we've been really good. The COO meets with the CHR every month, so do I. And Carl's been great, though. He's our COO. It really challenging them and asking tough questions and making sure, and they're great, too, on what we can do to continue to extend that break-even point. And we've been able to do it so far, so I'm confident we can do something to continue to push that time horizon out, which is the goal, I believe, of the commissioners, to have that thing be at least break-even. So what are we working on right now? Well, we already talked about the 911. It's just gigantic for us. We talked about, we didn't talk about truancy and parking, but there is legislation that's been proposed that would remove those from the district court system. And for example, in Reading, that's about 20 to 25,000 cases that go through that system. And clearly, if we were able to remove that, we should be able to have lower cost in the...
Just a clarification, they're actually a little bit different. The parking legislation would decriminalize parking.
Okay.
The truancy legislation doesn't remove it from the MDJ offices. It takes a jail sentence off the table as an option and replaces it with community service and, of course, the fines that were already there. Just for clarification, they're a little bit different. Parking, you're right, would take it completely out because it decriminalizes it, but not the truancy legislation.
Thank you, Commissioner. Consolidation of certain city MDJ locations. If we were able to take three MDJs that are surrounding the courthouse and put them in one location, in this building, for example, we estimate that we could save $150,000 a year. You know, so it's something that we're certainly interested in looking at. Alternate ownership of MDJs. I invite the public to come to the budget meeting this afternoon. We're going to talk a little more about this, but this has the opportunity to save just for one location, one MDJ location, close to $20,000 a year in savings in rent and $400,000 over 20 years. Consolidate. Kim, why don't you pull all the other ones up for me, please? So you look at consolidate, automate assessment and land records. You look at children, youth services, case management system, operational assessments, which we have one going on in children, youth services right now, and I believe...
And aging is about to be completed.
Aging, and eventually one in Prathi?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So it's CYS aging and prothonotary, just to name a few. Implementation of unified case management system, completion of phase two and three civil e-filing system. You can take all those, and they go into the directive the commissioners actually gave 2 years ago. It's time now to look for efficiency in the service delivery for our services. And all of those are focused on that. And all of those have the potential to lower our cost of service. And so they're high priorities. A few of those you'll recognize were on the capital plan, separately stated on the capital plan. So you know, I just wanted to emphasize that. And then, of course, we're going to continue to focus on overtime and limit the use of overtime in every way possible. Two items I didn't have on there, we're currently looking to enhance our returns on our investments. Investment policy is almost ready to be approved. And we're also looking forward out there now with, and seeing if it makes sense to retire some debt out there that might be carrying 3-4% interest on it out, you know, maybe 15, 20 years from now. Well, that completes the presentation today. So what are the next steps? On December 18th, the Board of Commissioners will be asked to formally adopt the budget for 2015. And as of this afternoon, the budget that we've just gone over, the presentation, the written budget message that I alluded to earlier, the budget book, will be available for inspection at the County Commissioner's Office, our office, the Budget Office, and we'll also have it out on our county website at www.co.berks.pa.us. So with that, Commissioners, I thank you for your time, and I turn it over to you three for comment or questions, and even to anyone in the audience that might have comments or questions.